My name is Amanda Jaguer. I'm the director of outreach here at the Colorado Shakespeare Festival, and I'm so delighted that you're all here on this beautiful Monday to learn a little bit about I Hate Hamlet, which was not written by Shakespeare, as some of you may know, or you will learn tonight. You'll talk about that, okay? Shakespeare.
Oh, hold on.
Let me add that to your list. I Hate Hamlet is the second production in our 2014 summer season to open. The first, The Tempest, opens this Saturday, when it will not rain, I hope. It's not the exception. I Hate Hamlet opens on Friday, June 13th, the lucky day, on our indoor stage. And then the other productions in our summer season are The Merry Wives of Windsor, which opens June 28th, I think. Our dramaturg is right here. As well as Henry the Fourth Part 1 and Henry the Fourth Part 2, which will open in July. Well, Henry the Fourth Part 2, you'll learn about in a couple of weeks. It's a little bit different. But tonight I'm delighted to welcome Roxy Duda, our incredible dramaturg and assistant director, who has made some really cool discoveries about John Barrymore and his production, as well as Katie Horney, our costume designer, who's got some very beautiful costumes, or very cool costumes. Yeah. And they're going to be talking about the summer. At the end of tonight's talk, we will do a drawing for tickets to opening night of I Hate Hamlet. So if you don't already have your tickets, you could win them this evening, as long as you've entered the drawing in the back. And if you do already have your tickets, you can give them away to your friend and come. Just so kind. Thanks so much for being here tonight. We will have time for questions at the end. And let me turn it over to Roxy and Katie.
Ceiling.
The broker was chatting, and she mentioned that the apartment had once been the home of John Barrymore. Here's how long ago this was. I didn't snap up the place that very minute, but told the broker that I'd phone him the next morning. And that is where our play takes place, this beautiful apartment, which John Barrymore called the Alchemist's Corner. As we heard from Paul Rudnick, it has these amazing textural qualities to it, stained glass windows that were breathtaking. Not to mention just sort of a feeling of theatricality when you walk into the space. And that's really what our set designer tried to accomplish, which we'll talk about a little later on. So now I just want to give you a quick rundown of what the play's about, but I don't want to ruin it for you. I don't want to give you too much. So just as a teaser, obviously John Barrymore is going to make a presence in the play. But he shows up to us as a ghost. And he sort of has dealings with the modern dwellers of the apartment. So it's as if Paul Rudnick never moved into the apartment, but rather a young, hotshot Hollywood actor named Andrew Rowley, who's just got finished with a series that got canceled for various reasons and has decided to come out to New York and play Hamlet in that summer's Shakespeare in the Park. And that's pretty much all I want to tell you about it, because the play is so funny and it's so jam-packed with amazing jokes and amazing lines. But I think if I tell you anything else, I'm going to ruin it. So you really just have to come and see it. It's wonderfully funny. Sam Gregory plays our Barrymore, and he's amazing. He's just fantastic. So I would love to tell you a little bit about the production history of I Hate Hamlet. The most interesting thing about the production was what a terrible mess it was when it first started. So Paul Rudnick wrote this great play, got picked up very easily, and the only problem that they were having when they were workshopping it was that they couldn't find a Barrymore, a true great Barrymore, because he is such a character, not just in the play, but in real life. He was this amazing, larger-than-life person. So it was hard to find someone to fill that role. Eventually, they came across an actor who I'm sure some of you will recognize the name of, named Nicole Williamson, or Nicole, as he pronounced it. And while he played Barrymore on stage very well, he also took a lot of Barrymore's faults home with him. So not only did he have trouble with alcoholism during his time as Barrymore, but he ended up alienating much of the cast and crew, very diva-like persona that he had. And he actually eventually ended up injuring his co-star on one of the first evenings of the show. He actually stabbed him in the derriere during a fight scene. And it was just kind of a mess. So it ended up that was more what the press wanted to talk about and less about the play itself. And so it sort of went out of style for a few years, until recently it's been picked back up by a lot of summer stock and a lot of Shakespeare festivals specifically, for a good reason. which brings me to why we do this play. I promise I'll get into costumes. I'm just sitting here.
I find this interesting as well.
Which brings me to why we do this play. I just want to read for you, it's a very small line, but for myself and for Tim, our director, it is probably the most important line in the play. It really boils down why we feel the play is necessary now. Barrymore says to Andrew, the up-and-coming Hollywood star, "Hamlet will change you, make no mistake about it." And when Tim was first talking to me about this play, he really stressed that line, because that's what we want to talk about. We want to talk about, why do we still do Shakespeare? I'm sure everyone in this room, being here, you have an appreciation for the text and for the amazing works of Shakespeare. We've done it for I don't know how many years. But it seems like more and more we have to answer that question. As academics, as lovers of Shakespeare and theater, we have to ask the question, why do we still do this? There's all these wonderful playwrights that have existed since Shakespeare did. There's all this great work that's happening in modern times. So why do we still keep going back to this same man and doing the same stuff we've always done? And I think the reason is because it changes us. Each time you look at the text, each time you go and experience Shakespeare, something new happens. And it's not so much that we're, you know, changing it or making these drastic new realizations about the text, but rather that we are coming to it and it is changing us. So that's kind of what I hope Tim would say if he were here. Also, I just think it's also very funny. It's very humorous. The play is, actually, I know it is. You guys are going to love it. But I think it's great to have a show in a Shakespeare summer stock season where the title of it is I Hate Hamlet. I just think that's lovely. There's just a sort of rounded symmetry to that that is so fantastic. But another really great thing about this play, as I already talked about, is John Barrymore. There are a few actors who you could really compare to this man with any sort of helpfulness. He really was an enigma. And in his time, he made so many people appreciate not just Hamlet, but Shakespeare. His Hamlet is still lauded as one of the greatest American Hamlets ever, of all time. And some people would say at all, not just American, but ever. So it's, I think, important for us to look at that man and think, why was he able to move so many people to not only appreciating Shakespeare, but to come back to it time and time again. So we're sort of trying to cultivate that as well. So now I'd like to move on to the really interesting thing that I'm going to talk about today, which is all of this great research that I've done and really had a blast doing that actually ended up giving me a really great thing for my career, and I feel so honored to have found it. So when Tim, our director, asked me to start researching the play, I did two basic, searches, looked at scholarly articles on the topic, on John Barrymore, and I came across an article in Smithsonian Magazine that was just, basically giving a general rundown of John Barrymore, what sort of person he was, and in a little footnote at the bottom of the page, there was a mention of a special collection that we have in our Norlin Library that we house at the University of Colorado Boulder. And it said that, there was further information here should anyone think to look at it. But it didn't say much more than that. So I thought, I'll go give it a shot. We'll see what's in there. So I walk into Special Collections, and I ask the wonderful librarians for their help. And I asked them for the Gene Fowler collection. Now, I'm sure many of you know who Gene Fowler was, but he happened to be the best friend of John Barrymore and also John Barrymore's biographer. I asked the librarians for the Gene Fowler collection, and they said, which part? And they proceeded to bring out part upon part upon part. There was something like 220 boxes of materials in the Gene Fowler collection. And because, even though our library is full of wonderful staffers, there's just not enough people to go through that much information. So it was not well indexed, especially the part that I was looking for, of course. And so I ended up just having to go through each individual box. And I was starting to get a little frustrated, couldn't really find anything. And then suddenly I came across John Barrymore's birth certificate. And from there, it just was a fountain of information. I'd like to show you some of the wonderful items that I found. These are facsimiles of those items. This little stack are just pictures, just photographs, of the Alchemist's Corner, which is the apartment that we just referred to. Some of them are close-ups of specific fixtures of the apartment. Some are outside shots of the apartment. Some of those are photographs from a newspaper article that was written in the 30s about that same apartment. So just lots of really great information and material on that. Besides things like his birth certificate or the contents of his wallet at his death that included his things Bernard Shaw and vice versa. I found personal documents such as three of his four bills of divorcement.
It was really special.
Yeah, that fourth one they just had to keep back. I found canceled checks, and when I say canceled checks, I don't mean two or three, I mean a stack about this big, because John Barrymore's not so great with his finances. I found letters that John Barrymore wrote to his daughter explaining why he wasn't going to be there for her birthday because he was just too busy in Hollywood and couldn't make it back. And as I started to page through document upon document wearing white gloves, because they were documents that hadn't been looked at in 40 plus years. Some of them were falling apart in my hands. As I started to page through them, I started to realize that the image that I knew of John Barrymore, the one that I had been researching for the past few weeks, was not even close to the total picture of this very complicated man. John Barrymore's public persona was very much a philandering, womanizing sort of gentleman, kind of like a old school Rat Pack kind of guy. And he cultivated that persona very well. But in his private life, he was really a romantic. He loved so passionately that he ended up getting married and divorced four times. All he wanted to do was stake a claim for himself and be a man worthy of the parts that he loved to play. The thing that was most prevalent in the collection were photographs of not only the Alchemist's Corner, but also of John Barrymore's Hamlet and material surrounding that, which is what I'm going to pass out right now. These are various photographs of John Barrymore playing Hamlet in his original costume, as well as a program, I believe it's in there, the original program. And Hamlet obviously has a lot to do with our play. The entire time during the play, the ghost of John Barrymore is wearing his Hamlet costume. We're going to talk about that momentarily. But the great thing about finding these materials in the collection is that those photographs that you're looking at, which look much better in person, it's hard to take a facsimile of them, some of those photographs have not been seen by other people. So they're not photographs you can find on the internet. It's really difficult to get access to them. And so we were able to use those photographs to really make something amazing, costume-wise, that other productions were not able to do. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to you if you want to talk about costumes a little bit.
So I guess the most appropriate costume to start off with is then John Barrymore's. Like Robert said, he's dressed as his production of Hamlet, though as a ghost and a man, he's aged a bit, so you're not really seeing John late 20s, early 30s John Barrymore. You're seeing a much older, mature, lessons of life John Barrymore. But because his whole purpose is to come back and teach about Hamlet being an actor, we wanted, and the script dictates, that he be dressed as Hamlet. There's been lots of productions, and several costume designers have reimagined what John Barrymore's Hamlet costume was. When we came across this kind of research, it just seems silly to try and reinvent the wheel on it. And I heard that we had all these great images, and the director and I talked and really agreed we should try and recreate this costume as best as possible. And I was pulling up the same kind of online images. Every other costume designer who's designed this and decided to go that way with the costumes did, and was giving a really good idea, and we're pulling up different ones from different poses and trying to understand the seam lines of it. And then I was able to join Roxy in the library and look at these production photos that are such a higher quality than, you know, photos that have been scanned in and long since kind of overly digitized. And I was able to discuss discover certain things about the costumes that me and the costume staff had completely missed in our fuzzy research images. And there are a lot of small details that maybe used to mean the audience wouldn't have realized that it's now this much more accurate, but it really means a lot to our actors sometimes to be able to give them these kind of little key things that they can hold on to and feel the character ever so much more because it's so much, because it's another step of authenticity. Like one particular detail is, it's a simple black tunic, and it opens and there's this white shirt underneath, and we kept seeing this very odd little medallion sort of thing, because there's a chain that goes around the neck, and we kept wondering, like, is that like this dagger, but it's like, this like a leather opener size, and we're just kind of guessing at it. And then when I was able to go back to look at the original production post, we're like, oh no, that's the opening of the shirt, it's just another button. And it was one of those things that, it, like I said, it's another layer of authenticity I was able to give, because if not, it was going to be some funny little magical pin thing. But now, you know, the actor gets to feel that role even more, knowing his costume is even more accurate. So it's been kind of a fun thing. It's always a little nerve-wracking as a designer, not just replicating a period, but trying to replicate a outfit. Now, luckily, not too many people in the audience will have seen the original production, so I did get a little bit of fudge room there. But it's this beautiful, simple, elegant costume. I think very indicative of the period in theater when he was performing it, because whenever we design costumes from a particular period in time, we're always designing them through the lens of the day we're in, based by just our own personal aesthetics, and as well as the materials we're able to get a hold of. You'll see a lot more polyester, unfortunately, in Hello Dolly than ever existed back in that time, because there was not back then. But it's always what we can get our hands on. So it is a beautiful, simple, lovely garment. And then the rest of the characters exist in this whole different world. The play was written in 91, and our director thought it would be, and it's a modern day world, John Barrymore has come back to interact with. Our director thought it would be really fun, instead of going with today's modern day world, if we went back to the early 90s with it, and just kind of enjoyed some of, and play on some of those iconic things about the early 90s that, you know, fashion always seems like a good idea when you're wearing it. You get a little perspective. And there's even a moment in the second act when the main character, our young TV star, comes in his Hamlet costume. And it is early 90s interpretation of his Hamlet costume. So where John Barrymore in this beautiful, elegant, simple, hopefully, costume. New early 90s Hamlet is kind of puffed up, and there's trim upon trim, and made shiny, and, you know, very kind of eye-catching. So it's a fun, there's lots of points in the show where it's a fun conflict between classic Barrymore Hamlet and loud 90s. So kind of working on that. The costume design is set in the early 90s, and another thing when it comes to designing in a period, which is so funny because now I refer to the 90s as a period, but it's been a long time. We all remember it through our own sort of lens. There's all these kind of things, fashions you wore from a time that friends were willing to wear, but that was your iconic mark. So all the characters, while dressed in the early 90s, have kind of their own version of it, because with all things in fashion and style, we don't look identical to the person sitting next to us. We have all of that independent personality shining out. So, and the 90s were a very beloved period to me, as they were pretty much my childhood, but the one I remember was when you're born in. It was a lot of fun doing the research for this, because often when I'm designing period shows, it's a lot of time spent in the library, going back over bustles or medieval tights and learning a lot of interesting things. And I was on Google looking up Melrose Place and 90210. And what did Brad Pitt look like before we like really knew he was a star? So it was a lot of fun and a lot of falling down rabbit holes of bad fashion. I remembered wearing myself. So it's been a lot of fun, and it is kind of a lighthearted comedy, so it is more kind of playing up some of the tackier elements of the period. One of the characters who is the real estate agent that finds the apartment, when the director and I were talking, we were talking in these very kind of iconic TV roles, and we're just like, Fran Drescher from The Nanny. It's like one big hair and short and bright and, you know, abrasive, which is always great because you talk about these things and then the actors come in, because the director and I have a conversation months before the actors come in and start rehearsing, and sometimes you create this character and you're there, and then the actor comes in and we're like, okay, or we're going in a whole different direction. But our actress was just, when she heard it, she loved it. She seems to be going big,
so
bold. So there's also one of the other agents has, because it's early 90s, has a little bit of Miami Vice kind of flair to him. Little loafers without socks and rolled up jacket sleeves. So it's just been a lot of fun. And it's been a lot of fun to try and kind of remember these things to pick on, but not going into such absurd fashion elements that we occasionally forget, they get distracting. As I remember, the MC Hammer pants were very short-lived but popular, but I think to actually put anyone on stage,
that's all we're looking at.
Right, it would be a great laugh for the beginning, and then 10 minutes later you would still be going, but why is he wearing those? So it is sometimes a fun balance to make costumes amusing, but not distracting beyond their initial entrance.
Great. I think one of my favorite things that happened in rehearsal most recently is the man who plays Gary, who sort of got that Miami Vice look that he was just talking about, said something about Miami Vice to me, and I was like, what's that? And everyone in the rehearsal hall got very upset with me all at once. But I was born in 91, so it got a little harder for me to sort of wrap my head around the period. And they were like, well, we'll just look at our home photos. Well, I was wearing onesies, so it's not exactly the same for me, but I can sort of get the feeling. But yeah, so that's good. So that's really fun. So thank you very much for that. So yeah, you can see that the great materials that we were able to find in the library were really helpful for that one particular costume, and then everything else was just 90s, go. But other reasons that the research that I was able to find were so important and so interesting, all of those photographs that you guys see about the Alchemist Corner really played into our scenic designer's design of the set. Down to even some of the trimmings that she did, the stains on the woodwork. I mean, all of, some of the tiniest little details that you wouldn't really think would matter, but when you see it all together, and you see her model or you see her renderings, it's amazing. It transports you to this very specific time and place, this very type of place. What's really great is, I'm gonna pass around these paint elevations, which are just great little photographs of bits and pieces of the set. So you won't get to see the whole thing, mostly because I don't want you to. Yeah, because I want you to really get the experience of walking in and feeling that space. So there's just some things, but you'll see in her renderings a couple of stained glass windows that are almost exactly like the ones I passed around a picture of earlier. The wallpaper. She has this really great pattern on the wallpaper that is specifically from the apartment as well. The fireplace and the mantle around the fireplace is almost exactly the same. So there's a lot of stuff that's really authentic. But the thing about that authenticity, like Kate said, sometimes, like if you're sitting in the audience, you might not, very likely you won't know that it's authentic. And sometimes, to me, especially as a dramaturg, it's like, why are we doing all this work? You know, no one's going to know the difference. But the other day I got to see a model of the set. And even just this miniature version, I looked at it and I thought, that makes me, like that is evoking this amazing emotion in me. The set is really kind of like its own character in this play. And if it were, if it didn't have those very specific fixtures and those very specific wallpaper types and trimmings, I don't think you would get the same feeling. I think it would feel phony and just not quite the same. When I looked at this, it was almost like, I don't know if anybody's ever had the feeling of walking into a big cathedral or a church and just being sort of like awe-inspired. I know that sounds like I'm being overdramatic, but it's very true. I cannot wait for you to see the set. So that's another way we used it. Another great thing that I am able to do in the rehearsal room is, like I said, Sam Gregory is our John Barrymore, and he's wonderful. And something that's really great is, every once in a while, our director will say, okay, Sam, do something Barrymore-esque. And Sam will go, okay, I don't know what that is. And he'll turn to me and I'll go, let me look up something. And I'll grab one of the many wonderful photographs of the production of Hamlet that we have, and I'll say, well, Sam, you're already sitting on the floor. And here's a really good picture of John Barrymore sitting on the floor doing this very intricate pose. Why don't you try that? And he will, and it looks amazing, and it looks so fantastic, and it looks so very Barrymore. And it's just great to get to really utilize that research from day to day. So I'm really excited because I get to also do a lobby display in conjunction with this production. So when you go and see the production, when you come out and enter or step into the lobby, you'll get to see a lot of these photographs in much higher quality than they are here. And I think, I imagine people will chuckle, at least I hope they will, after having seen Sam hit all these amazing poses, and then you'll see all those same poses in the lobby, and you'll go, oh, I remember when you did that, was hilarious. And it's just really wonderful to get to have that sort of impact on the production. Let's see. I want to walk faster than I am, so get going. But the last thing that I wanted to talk about before we do questions, which I know I went very fast, I'm sorry. The last thing that I wanted to talk about is the juxtaposition between the modern and the sort of, I don't want to call it old, but the classic, thank you, the classic that is John Barrymore. So you're going to get to see a lot of that, and it really is pervasive in every element of the play. So, for instance, our wonderful costume designer told you about the fact that all of these characters are wearing these 90s clothes, and then here's John Barrymore in this beautiful classic costume. And it's just, all at once, it's very interesting, and it's also very, it's a hotbed for hilarious happenings. Especially when the various characters in the play, so Andrew can see John Barrymore and talk to him and interact with him, but other characters cannot. And so it's really wonderful to have John Barrymore sort of walking around the apartment in this very intricate costume while others don't even know he's there and are totally oblivious to his presence. And they're just wearing these very interesting, funny things. So that's really great. Another thing that I really like is the furniture in the space. So when you walk in, you're going to see this beautiful set. And it's going to be lovely and beautiful and wonderful. But then also there's going to be, like, you know, a very modern couch sitting there.
And a
boombox. And a
boombox. So all these other kind of very modern, clashy things.
Exactly. So you're going to get all of those elements, and it's sort of unsettling, but also very funny. And another thing that I'm really enjoying right now, because we're in the middle of choreographing, there's a big fight scene. I won't tell you too much about it, because it's hilarious. I don't want to ruin it for you. But there's a great juxtaposition between John Barrymore and his sort of grandiose fencing type of fighting, very like Danity Kane, you know, sort of fighting. Very Boulevard comedy-esque. And then there's Andrew, who doesn't know what he's doing. and so he's just sort of lumbering around with two hands on his, what is a fencing sword called?
Okay.
There you go. Yeah, all of those things. you know, just sort of like broadswording it and not doing a very good job. And so it's just hilarious. That juxtaposition is so pervasive in our play, and it is where a lot of the comedy comes from. And so I'm really excited, and like I said, I feel really honored to be able to have contributed so much to that aspect of the production.
Did you have anything else
you wanted to say? Oh, I passed them around. I passed them around while you were speaking. Yeah. So I think that's all that I have. So open up for questions if that's okay. Yes.
Talked about the different costumes, the very more traditional costume and the contemporary. What about the acting style on the dialogue? Barrymore was kind of over the top and so forth. Is that his character on stage here, or with the compared to the contemporary TV star who's going to be Hamlet?
So the very interesting thing about this play is that a lot of it is Barrymore trying to teach Andrew, who's the contemporary Hollywood star, how to be a good actor. And of course, Barrymore believes that a good actor is a Barrymore actor. One of my favorite lines in the play is John Barrymore saying, "I was alive just long enough to see the invention of truth into the modern theater." And he says it like it's the worst thing that's ever been said, just like a bad taste in his mouth. And so, you know, our Andrew is constantly trying to find that like method acting, that truth in his character. And John Barrymore says, "The text does it for you, it's all there." So in that, in the times when John Barrymore is teaching Andrew, he's very grandiose, he's very big, he's very loud, all that quintessential John Barrymore stuff. And yes, a lot of our other characters are sort of more down to earth. But at the same time, Sam does a really good job of knowing when to be Barrymore and when to be a true person. So like I said, Barrymore was a very complicated man. So he had that grandiose nature that he sort of cultivated as his public image. But we also see a lot of private moments of Barrymore in the play. And in those private moments, there's this really special, intimate sentimentality that you get to see in him, and Sam does a really good job of juxtaposing those two things. So you get to see a little of both.
Yes.
Oh, let's go here and then here.
The original play came out in the 90s.
1991.
And so their costumes would have been the 90s costumes?
Yes.
And that's a funny.
Right. I think all that is the humor really came from just Barrymore appearing in between there. But yeah, and the show definitely plays up, I think, how the modern world 91 is so in contrast to the world Barrymore knows. So anyone thinks like the costumes themselves were probably not amusement at the time, but we did kind of have a lot of fun, not only with the costumes, like I said, with the props and the scenery, of really kind of driving home that kind of period. And one thing our director commented on is, what a terrible time for Barrymore to come back, because a lot of television was just kind of frivolous at the time. We didn't have all those great HBO series yet, and 90s were kind of bold and bright just in their own natural state. So while the 90s in and of themselves weren't humorous at the moment, it is kind of a really terrible time, television and art form on film, for Barrymore, man on stage, to find himself stuck in. Which was also kind of hard
to do. Or maybe it was the perfect time for it.
Right. Or it's ideal. We need the most right now.
I feel kind of thoroughly
questioned
in the series. You're not doing a garden, right?
I'm sorry?
You're not doing his garden?
His garden? No. No, it would have been very cool, but there are, I'm sure all of you have seen something on that stage. There are certain limitations that we have to deal with, and one of them is height. That's just something that sort of had to get cut. Also, no scenes actually take place there in the play. Paul Rudnick sort of wrote it that way so that it could be sort of one of those one set, one room boulevard comedy type of situations.
Yes,
we do. Yeah. So he wrote it specifically so that everything does happen in that one space.
But there is mention doesn't, you know, go unnoticed.
People walk up there and people say, I'm going to the rooftop or whatever. So it's definitely still a presence, but it's not physically there. No, that's fine.
I just thought it was amazing that it had Cypress Street and said something like tons and tons of dirt and cypress trees put in.
Yeah, there's actually, that's actually something that he got in a lot of trouble for. As you saw in the photographs, there was a rooftop area also associated with John Barrymore's Alchemist Corner. And on this rooftop, he wanted to make just a beautiful, lavish garden, and like you just said, he had cypress trees and all sorts of things up there. And in order to do this, he brought tons and tons of dirt on the roof, so much that he started to mess with the structural integrity of the roof, and he was forced to remove it. So that definitely was a very paranoid thing to do.
Are you doing anything with your research beyond the show?
Myself? Yes, I'm going to probably write an article about it. I feel like it would be a waste not to. And I've already had a few colleagues mention it to me outside of this program, so I think it's definitely going to get me a lot of mileage academically and career-wise, certainly. So can't wait for conferences this summer. It's definitely in my back pocket. So yeah, absolutely. Yes?
Is this play kind of a one-off genre? I'm thinking of plays like Kiss Me, Kate, and West Side Story, and Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, but they don't quite fit this type of a take on it. In your research, was that interesting? Did you look into any of that?
Yeah, I did actually, and you're right. It's sort of a class of its own. There are things definitely that you can compare to it, but every time you try to compare something to it, you have to give it a caveat, right? Like, there's nothing really that fits into the same category. There are a lot of plays that have, you know, people who were actually alive in them, right? So there's a lot of plays that have true characters, true people in them. There's a lot of plays that are about Shakespeare that aren't Shakespeare. There's a lot of plays that are about theater, but none that really encapsulate all of those things. And I think it's really to Paul Rudnick, our playwright's credit, that he's able to do it, but make it seem so fluid and so funny at the same time. So there's a message. There's a lot of great things that he talks about in the play, but at the same time, you're going to be laughing every 2 minutes. I mean, it's crazy funny. And that, to me, is an amazing skill. And I feel like it's something that the Shakespeare Festival is, you know, it's really going to be great for the festival. Because you'll get to see all these wonderful, you know, all these great Shakespeare plays. But then you also get to see this really funny, like I said before, boulevard comedy is sort of what we're going for. And our director, Tim, likes to say to people that this play should be like a glass of champagne. It should just be delicious and have a lot of body to it, but at the same time, it should be refreshing and wonderful and lovely. Does that answer your question?
But there's another thing talking about, yeah, this is a classic question. What would she say for the rest?
Yeah, I think
it speaks well to, like, the clowns he always likes to throw into things to keep things lively and fun. And there's a lot of, in the show, there's a lot of respect for the play Hamlet, and especially the role in and of itself, because Hamlet is a role that a lot of actors just are dying for their chance to take on. It's often even played by actors older than kind of the suspected, like, early 20s, mm-hmm. Hamlet, because it's such a big role, and it's got so much emotion to get through, and complexity, that a lot of times we cast older, more experienced actors, because so many of the young ones just don't quite have the depth yet. And this show always respects the fact that Hamlet is a big role and a desirable role. Now, there's certain characters who kind of pick at it, but it has a big respect for the play, which I think is really nice, and it's nice to kind of keep and balance with the levity of what we're having fun of doing Shakespeare in the Park. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's a really great viewpoint on the play, and I think that most of the people doing the show would agree with Katie on that, and she's completely 100% right. I think he wouldn't like it, but great balance in the play of people saying, you know, oh, Hamlet's this, just this, it's such a difficult, it's so complex and so emotional. And then there's somebody who will come and say, yeah, but not really, though. Like, everybody dies in the end, guys. What a big shocker. You know, there are definitely moments and jokes in there where there are holes poked into that, this idea of this, like, you know, big grandiose thing that nobody can understand or touch, right? There are a lot of characters who bring up the fact of, like, well, how do we know if we're doing good Shakespeare? Does anybody really know anymore if it's good or not? Or do we all just kind of assume that it's good because we don't really know? And that's something, I love those lines in the play, and I love those characters in the play, because as an academic, sometimes you're not allowed to ask those questions in classrooms or in spaces with other academics. You sort of have to just go, oh, yes, Shakespeare. Yes, Shakespeare. And not in my classroom, of course. I have wonderful teachers, but I think that is a culture definitely that is cultivated in you know, among theater people. And for me, this play is so great because it says, okay, that's true, but also it's not. You know, so I think there's definitely both of that in there. So maybe you wouldn't. Who knows?
I think the director would be really happy we have different opinions on that, because that was part of what he liked about the show.
Exactly. Yes.
What if someone had never seen Hamlet or maybe had seen it once? Would they still find this play funny?
Oh yes, absolutely. Because a lot of what the playwright does is really when he talks about Hamlet, he touches on those iconic moments of Hamlet. So something that's discussed, I would say most of the play, is the to be or not to be soliloquy. Yeah. So even if you've never seen Hamlet or read Hamlet, you've heard that soliloquy, or at least you've heard the first line of that soliloquy, so you know what they're talking about. So while you might not have the same appreciation as somebody who is a Hamlet or Shakespeare lover, it's still gonna be funny for you. Yes?
When did you come upon this collection?
Oh, in special collections?
Timing-wise, in terms of, because you said it influenced the set, the actual set as it is now.
Yes, it did.
So when did you actually?
It was in early December that I found it originally, and then it took me about a month and a half to parse through all of the materials, and I actually created an index for the materials, so that took a little while.
So the set design was still early in this section, because, I mean, is the set design from here?
Yes.
Oh, she's okay. From Denver. Yes, all of this...
So it wasn't something that, you know, because they used to have things with... They bring in when people at a certain early on and then at the second time, especially when a lot of the cast came from out of town.
Well, we did that here too. It just happens that our set designer was in Denver.
And we did start on independent design meetings with the director probably around mid to late January. And so at that, we had been hired before, and the script had been picked long before we knew we had all this, but we didn't start into the conversation until actually after the point that we knew we had this collection, and at that point, us as designers hadn't had a chance to look at it, but we knew it was going to be there very soon for our resource. And I believe I was probably in the same time frame as the scene designers. So by the first time we had like our first official meeting as all of the designers and the director together, at that point we were all on the same page that we had all this research and had been able to access it from what Roxy was able to parse out to us, which was lovely to not have to go sort through 200 boxes myself.
So actually, you looked at how other, I mean, obviously it was a period when this was done at the beginning, and then, but more recently it's been done. Did you look at what other groups had done?
Often in research, you just kind of look at other productions, just kind of out of curiosity. And it's funny, I typed John Barrymore into my Google search quite often, bringing up like the Tunic, whatever necessary. And when you type that in, you always seem to get other productions of this play have become pretty high up on the list of kind of pretty easy. Which is where I know that some other costume designers did do the classic Barrymore Hamlet costume, and other ones decided to do their own interpretation of it.
And I know that our scene designer did look at some other productions, and her initial ideas before we knew we had this collection were sort of based on the original production's scene design because Gene Fowler lived in that apartment, so it was similar to what the apartment would have looked like, so that was what she was basing things off of. But at the same, like, even production photos back then weren't, even in the early 90s, weren't as good as they are now, and so she wasn't getting, you know, really specific bits. So while she had, like, a general structure, pretty much everything she did to her, which field I feel bad about, because she had to redo her whole scene design, but pretty much everything she had initially, she had to change, because she wanted to make it more authentic. Any other questions?
Talk about the Merry Wives of Windsor at 7 p.m. in this room. See y'all next week.
Thank you so much.